with the command file, we get also information about any file that exists on your system. In particular, it works for object files and programs. So if I call the program file on example.o, tell us more information about this particular file called example.o. It's relocatable, and it is for x86 64-bit system. It has debug info. Yeah, not stripped means there is not the debug info and further information removed from this object file. Okay, well, we can use the tool LDD, which is the Linux loader, which tool to identify what dependencies we have in regards to libraries. And it says here it's not a dynamic executable because it's not a program. But what we have to do is we want to create an executable now. So let me compile our original C code to our program called example, and let's run it LDD on a full-featured program. And now we see that this program depends on three libraries. This library here, the libc, which is the C standard library, and this one is found in this location. And then we have lastly this LD Linux, which is the loader program library for the loader itself that it finds over here. So not too many dependencies for this little program. And what we can do as well, we can create assembler code using the uppercase S, and it's nice to include further information using this F verbus. So let's have a go with this command. Compiled it. Now let's have a look at example.s, which is the assembly code of this particular source code, C source code. So it shall open in a second. Here we go. So here we see a lot of information. Yeah, and to make it better, yeah, you know, this is a large, potentially large file. We have a couple of hundred lines, but this is now assembly code annotated, which gives us the information what has happened. So we have here a little bit of debugging information. So this file here stems from the source file example.c. And then we get information about the different objects that are in there. What we have is, for example, gvar. We know that this has a size of 4 because it's an integer variable. It's part of the, that's what it is. And we get information that there's f1 is global variable, and f1 is a function. And then we get the code for function f1. And here are some jump labels, and we get a couple of information. So when we have here basically part of the API, which is now system specific. So on x86, you want to do certain activities. Whenever you enter a function, you need to, for example, push this register base pointer and make sure that it points to the current stack frame such that the compiler can call functions recursively, and these functions can nest in our stack frames as we know about them. Those dot stuff, they are not part of the assembler itself. They are further information for the compilation process. So they are not machine code, but here are some assembler instructions now. Move Q, which is a quad word, should be moved from one of the registers to the other ones. And here we move along into this register EDI from the register base pointer memory address -20. Let me do a couple of things. Now, why this is so nice with the verbose is that we can see our lines in the code. Yeah, in example.c and line 6, we had this assignment, gvar should be 4. So the move L instruction here, for example, means to move in the memory location where RBP, this register points to at minus 4 memory offset, the value 4, which is the compiler knows that GVAR is located in the special location, and so it basically stores there the value 4. Yeah, so and then you can see all those instructions, what they are doing, how they are kind of converted to assembly. Yeah, and at the end, when you close the function, we have to stick to our calling conventions, pretty much clearing up the register base pointer, jumping back using the return assembly call instruction to return to whoever called this function. Same for function 2. Yeah, so there's a lot of stuff in here. You can have a look what it does. I sometimes had a look what's going on, because the compilers, they can do certain optimizations which changes the outcome of such an assembly code. Okay, here we have a jump label, by the way. So in a for loop, you can have a look how the for loop is compiled into assembly code. Yeah, and printf function calls. Yeah, they need to call a function. It says printf call printf at plt, because that is pretty much an external function. Let's see if we find our f2. Yeah, our call to f2 should be somewhere exactly. So here it says call f2, which is a bit easier to understand. Let me just recompile our code again, and now we add really debugging symbols. And in the first step, let's see if that changes anything. And now you see the code is actually extremely huge, more than 4,000 lines of code. So all that get packed into our object file, and so that the compiler knows what's going on. And you can see basically for each memory address, we will know what data types there are, we know which files are included, and so on. All this information is needed to attribute everything that's going on in the back to the code, to the variables, how they are called, and so on. Yeah, because we remember, after the code is compiled, we have memory locations and all the information, what kind of objects they were, how they looked like, how they were named, is lost, except in the debug symbols. But other than that, our code looks pretty much the same on top here. So there's no magic here. Let me now compile it again and use O3, which is the optimization level 3, which makes changes the code. So, and again, if you look at this code, you find now some different types of instructions. For example, XOL, and you find, yeah, XOLs and less jumps, because it really removed the number of jump labels here. We have here 4 jump labels up to that point, because jump labels, they are really expensive. Yeah, so you can, of course, now understand what the compiler would do with your code, which is pretty nice. Okay, and how is this useful? Well, if you inspect your codes, try to understand the different machines, try to debug a problem in your compiler, which sometimes happens as well, and of course to hack a system. So let me real quick do one last thing. Once we compiled an application, like here, we can later inspect the object, this application file, in the ELF format using object dump, which then allows you to show what's going on inside this object, minus G3, I think. So now I do object dump minus X on example. And here we go, we get information about this ELF file. So what format does it have? It has the symbols, it's dynamic linked. We get something about the program header, not so interesting. We get information about the stack and the dynamic sections. Yeah, there's a lot of information here, the different types of sections, what it has. But we get also the symbol table. Yeah, here really detailed that is exists in this file. And you find that in the symbol table, by the way, of a executable, there is many more symbols because various symbols are needed to make the program executable. Yeah, that's all part of this ABI. What kind of format can the program loader of your operating system accept? Because it needs to do quite a job to load a program and get it started in memory here. Yeah? So there's a lot of things, and let me use NM on example. Here you find as well those additional symbols typically prefixed here with underscore underscore, which give you some hint what's in there. But still we see our original symbols like F1, F2, and Jiva and main. Printf here is already linked. It says here with add, this should be linked to the library called glibc in this version. So that's basically what's in here. And let's see if we can use object dump to help. And it has a lot of options to actually disassemble. Yeah, so you can get R-D to disassemble. You can use -D, as you just figured, to get back the assembly code of our program. And so we run object dump again, -D example. And so what you get for the different sections, you get the assembly code. And here I see this is a lot of extra code that's injected. There should somewhere be our F1 function. Here you go. And here you see how the assembly code looks like. And you can use this for hacking to some extent. As we've added also debug symbols, it tells us a little bit about the names of like this global object here that is being used. Yeah, so have a look with it. Try to do it, to use it on your own program a little bit. And we can use it, of course, with any program such as Bash, for example. So let's do NM on Bash, and you will find many symbols normally. But you know, this one is stripped. That's why there is no symbols. So if I run file, you probably find that information that it is going to be stripped exactly. But let's use LDD, then where we know at least the libraries. And here you see that there are a couple of more libraries used in Bash. And you will find a couple of programs on your computer that are not stripped, and that way you can get the symbols with NM. But surely I can use object dump -d, and here you get the assembly code of our binary program. And here's a lot in here. Let me go somewhere here at the end. So it's a lot of material. So that's how some people, like some hackers, disassemble and try to understand how programs work by looking at assembly code and then modifying it, possibly changing whatever it does to improve it or try to decipher certain activities that are done by this program. Yeah, anyway, I hope you find this helpful. I sometimes really have to use them. If you get a linker error, you may want to figure out why you get a linker error, then those tools come in handy. And that's why we actually show them. For your reference, here is basically all the outputs in case you have a problem to use these tools under your system environment.